Assalamu alaikum. I am Dr. Fiza Farooqi, Senior Registrar Microbiology at the Sindh Infectious Disease Hospital and Research Center. And I'll talk about using the laboratory for antimicrobial stewardship in your setting. I have no conflicts of interest. We'll talk about how the laboratory helps in clinical advice, how to commonly identify multi-drug resistant organisms, how to use the lab for infection control in your facility, and how the lab helps in collection, organization, and distribution of their data. Clinical advice, a good history is what will help both the clinician and the laboratory in deciding an appropriate treatment for the patient. Once the lab is provided with the appropriate history and the current treatment being used for the patient, they can use this information to employ the correct diagnostic test and use the correct antibiotics to check for susceptibilities in a sample, and also advise the clinician on what the most appropriate choice of treatment is. Once there is growth on culture, you can ask the laboratory whether the organism that is growing, if it is a sterile or sample, is gram-positive or gram-negative, and that can help in further narrowing down your treatment options. And a broad-spectrum antibiotic can be narrowed to one that covers at least one class of organisms and not both. And once you have antibiotic susceptibilities, it can further narrow down your antibiotic choice of treatment by choosing the narrowest spectrum of antibiotic. Why? Because as we all know, choosing broad spectrum antibiotics contributes to antimicrobial resistance in the community all around. Now, how to identify common multi-drug resistant organisms? The first one that we're going to talk about is methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, more commonly known as MRSA or even MRSA. The antibiotic that is reported in laboratory reports is methicillin or cloxacillin that can help us identify that the organism is MRSA. But if you do not have the final report and you're asking the laboratory preliminarily what antibiotic it's resistant to, then the antibiotic that you should ask about is cefoxitin. Cefoxitin is the antibiotic test that is used in the laboratory to check if it is MRSA or not, as it picks the resistance most adequately. Treatment of choice for MRSA, as we all know, is vancomycin. Thankfully, in our setting so far, we do not have reports of resistance to vancomycin yet. The next organism, which is gram-positive and we're going to talk about, is Enterococcus, and it is vancomycin-resistant Enterococcus. The laboratory tests vancomycin against it, and that is what is reported in the final report also. It is also more commonly known as VRE. The problem is that treatment of choice for VRE is linezolid, and linezolid is a drug that has a lot of difficult side effects. And due to its continuous misuse and it being an oral option in the community, we are now facing an emerging threat of linezolid-resistant Enterococcus, and we should be very careful about using linezolid in the outpatient setting. The next organism that we're going to talk about is a family of organisms known as carbapenem-resistant enterobacterials. These enterobacterials encompass organisms such as E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus providentia, Morganella, etc. The drug that is of concern over here is from the family of carbapenems, and they're more commonly known as CRE. Carbapenems include drugs such as imipenem, meropenem, doripenem, and ertapenem. However, the culture reports that you'll see from most laboratories will contain imipenem or meropenem or both. And these are what can help you identify if the organism is a CRE or not. We have limited treatment options for these, and most common ones that are used are colistin in our setting. Colistin, again, is a toxic drug, and therefore CREs should be watched for. The next family of organisms, and this is a newer term that we're going to use over right now, is difficult to treat resistant Pseudomonas aeruginosa, or DTR Pseudomonas aeruginosa. This term was mentioned in the recent most guidelines provided by the IDSA, and these should be looked at later. Now, a DTR Pseudomonas aeruginosa or multi-drug resistant Pseudomonas aeruginosa has to be resistant to more than three groups of antibiotics. Unlike CRE or MRSA or VRE, which had only one antibiotic to look for, over here you have to see the families of antibiotics and whether the organism is resistant to three or more of these families, and then only you can call them MDR, and infection control and treatment options are then seen for. treatment options for Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which is difficult to treat or multi-drug resistant, are usually susceptibility based, but the most common ones are again colistin. Another organism that should be seen right now is carbapenem resistant Acinetobacter baumannii, more commonly known now as CRAB or CRAB. Laboratory may not be able to report Acinetobacter baumannii or, you know, speciated. They usually report them as Acinetobacter species, and that alone, along with multi-drug resistant, just like Pseudomonas aeruginosa, it can be resistant to three or more families, should alert you to perform infection control and to worry about treatment options. Again, treatment options for this also include colistin, among other drugs, if available in the susceptibility profile. All of these multi-drug resistant organisms need appropriate infection control in the facility. Most laboratories, what they do is, once they identify these organisms and they perform susceptibilities, they notify clinicians, one, to tailor treatment and also to employ appropriate infection control precautions. However, if they do not notify you, or if the laboratory is not a hospital-based laboratory, but some other commercial laboratory, and it is not in their protocol to notify you, you can yourself call them, or if you see the report, you can identify whether this organism needs treatment or not based on the guidelines that were just given a while ago. Most common infection control precautions over here are contact precautions, which need a single room and glove gowns and masks. Collection, organization, and distribution of data. How laboratories help in these is mainly antibiograms. At regular intervals, usually 6 months or 1 year, different laboratories, if they have a large enough collection of organisms, they compile it and they tell you what percentage of these organisms was resistant to certain antibiotics, relevant antibiotics. And this data is distributed as antibiograms, both internally at the institutional level and even locally or countrywide through modalities such as the Pakistan Antimicrobial Resistance Network or the NIH. Some local antibiograms are available on parn.org.pk. And this is what they look like usually. You have an organism and you have an antibiotic given against it, and it tells you what percentage it is resistant or sensitive to it in both inpatient and outpatient settings. And this can be seen in detail in the antibiogram. In most antibiograms that publish them regularly. If you have any further questions, you can leave them in the comments and I'll be glad to answer them. Please like, share, and subscribe to the channel. Thank you.